So I'm going to be, this of course presentation is going to be in English. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us for IDI's briefing on how the coronavirus is affecting Israel's economy with Professor Karnit Flug. Karnit Flug is the former governor of the Bank of Israel. She is currently the vice president of research and the William Davidson Senior Fellow for Economic Policy at the Israel Democracy Institute and a professor at the Department of Economics in Hebrew University. Karnit's presentation will take around 20 minutes, and then we will open the discussion for questions. You can either write your questions in the chat option throughout, or you can ask them at the end. I would like to ask everyone to activate their mute button until Karnit is finished with her presentation. Karnit, the floor is yours.
Okay, so thank you very much, Danai. And I'll be talking about the economic consequences of the COVID-19 pandemic. And obviously, we're still at the, I would say, early stages of an evolving crisis. So these are some early thoughts. And as we all know, the outbreak of the pandemic and together with the measures that were taken by governments around the world in attempt to contain the spread are quickly dragging the world economy into a recession. And it seems that a recession is inevitable. However, its depth and duration are still unknown, and there are a lot of things unknown in this event. The duration and the extent of the recession will, to a large extent, depend on the evolution of the disease, but also on the severity and the duration of the lockdown or the restrictive measures that are imposed in order to limit the contagion. And also, it will depend on what measures governments will take as a policy response to these events. And governments have to take very rapid decisions without much time to think and without similar events to actually draw some conclusions from. And there are very difficult trade-offs that they're facing. And there is a lot that we still don't understand, and we have to learn along the time. Obviously, the first place where we can see the economic effect is the rapid decline in the value of the financial assets that shrunk around the globe, and this is just the Dow Jones to give a sense. And we've been hearing a lot recently about flattening the curve. And flattening the curve is an attempt to basically limit the number of people that will reach the healthcare system and trying to avoid flooding the system beyond its capacity. I should say that the Israeli financial system has been underfunded for many years, so the capacity is not as high as we would have liked it to be, but it should be said that no healthcare system, even if it's well-funded, can actually withstand such a tsunami. So everywhere, including in places where you have a very well-funded public health system, this attempt to flatten the curve is taking place. So what does it mean, or what does it imply, to flatten the curve? It means actually that we will have fewer cases at every point in time, but it's not clear that actually the overall number of people that will get the virus will be smaller, unless, of course, the vaccine is developed. But it prevents the healthcare system from being overwhelmed, and this means lower death rates because patients will get the needed treatment, ventilators, and so on. it will delay the peak of the crisis, and that makes the process longer, which may imply higher economic costs. But it also increases the chances that a better treatment and a vaccine will be found. So when we think about these trade-offs between the dealing or flattening the epidemic curve, we can think of the trade-off in terms of actually making the recession curve deeper. And you can see here in this illustration, this trade-off, that a flatter epidemic curve or healthcare curve implies a deeper recession when there is a stronger, when there are stronger measures to contain the epidemic. When we think about the economic impact of this pandemic, it's actually the effects are both on the supply and on the demand side. So we have shocks on both sides. The initial shock was disruptions in the supply chain because of the shutdown in China and some other Asian countries, then with the closures and travel bans, and then closures or shutdowns of domestic activity. All of this to some extent is mitigated by work from home, as we're doing right now using digital technology, but that's only mitigating the very substantial effect of the shock. So the restrictions on businesses on people actually has an effect both on the supply, because production is interrupted, and also on the demand, because consumption is interrupted. Add to that the sharp decline in the value of assets, this will have a negative wealth effect, which will further dampen consumption and investment. And this is all exacerbated by the very substantial uncertainty, sort of a Nietzschean uncertainty, the unknown unknowns. Obviously, the layoffs due to the shutdowns will further reduce consumption. And to the extent that these layoffs become permanent and we will have bankruptcies, this will slow the recovery and prolong the recession, because it's very difficult to actually start new businesses if businesses actually bankrupt. And also people, if they don't come back to their original original jobs, lose a lot of their specific human capital. And so a lot of investment in both human capital and in physical capital will be lost if people don't come back to their jobs, and if businesses don't don't go back to operation. And that's why fiscal policy is extremely important, because fiscal policy and credit policy can help people and firms withstand the shock and actually be there when the restrictions are lifted, and also support at the phase of recovery. There are very wide range of estimates regarding the loss of output in terms of GDP due to the restrictions imposed by the government. You see in this slide some estimates by the Bank of Israel, with the lowest estimate if the restrictions are lifted towards the end of April, and if the restrictions are partial, then we will have, then the lost output is about 3.5% of GDP, but it can be as high as more than 10% of GDP, according to the Ministry of Finance estimate, in a case where the restrictions or the lockdown goes on for more than 8 weeks, maybe 12, up to 12 weeks. And if it's more complete, right now, actually, we're already not in the, I would say, the least restrictive option, because the restrictions have already been intensified since this estimate was put forward. So what policies should be followed? And obviously, at the initial phase, the social distancing and the lockdown, in order to prevent infections and in order to prevent overflow of the public health system, were the right measures. I think soon we will start to have to think of an exit strategy with gradual lifting of the restrictions on the basis of information that will be available from large scale testing, and this is still a challenge. And once we have this information, we'll be able to have a partial or gradual lifting of the restrictions based on areas and communities according to their risks. And then there is a need for a very substantial fiscal and monetary accommodation in order to prevent the amplification of the damage due to the lockdown. And the main fiscal measures that need to be implemented and that are also part of what the government announced is obviously to allocate very large substantial resources to the health system, provision of unemployment insurance also to those who are temporarily laid off that would have not been eligible under normal circumstances. There are different groups that is not eligible or is very has very limited eligibility that is included and should be included. There is also treatment of the self-employed with some transfers that have already been announced. There is a large program of government guaranteed loans to small and medium businesses that is provided through the financial system. There is some reduction and postponement of some compulsory payments. And there is also a plan to support the recovery by a set of measures and projects. So all these elements are included in the package. We'll talk in a minute about some of the details. And when we look at the overall package, I should mention also the monetary policy or monetary measures. And again, here the measures that have been announced by the Bank of Israel include all the crucial elements, including the provision of liquidity, both domestic and in foreign currency, the relaxation of some additional capital buffers that had been accumulated during the good years so that banks can actually continue lending to solid firms and to households. And the Bank of Israel has been encouraging them to be forthcoming and actually provide the necessary credit. And also there was an encouragement, and the banks actually acted upon that to defer some payments, for example, payments of mortgages and so on. When we look at the overall package, the fiscal program that was announced by the Israeli government is roughly in the order of magnitude of packages that were announced also by other countries. You can see here, we made this international comparison using data from the IMF that was very recently announced, and the spending, the fiscal spending that was announced in that package is more or less in line. It's a bit more than the median fiscal package that was announced by other countries, and it has the main elements that we've seen in packages around the world. And the other part of the package is the government guaranteed credit, where in Israel is somewhat more modest than in some other countries. That are some countries where the government guaranteed credit is of massive proportions, and there are some countries that we don't have data about, but it's definitely a step in the right directions. It's, we still would need to see the details of these of the eligibility for credit. So I put here some two slides of the main components of the government announced package, aid package, and it includes employee support with some flexibilization of some of the eligibility criteria for unemployment benefit, health system support, I mentioned, growth support here. There are a lot of details that are yet unknown, and business sector support, which include both subsidy or grant for self-employed with two tacts, one this month and another next month, delay and some decline in VAT, municipal taxes and other payments, a reduction in the municipal taxes, and some other assistance, and very important, the state guarantee of loans for small and medium businesses. However, there we will have to see whether the conditions for these loans are such that will actually be sufficient for the banking sector to provide these loans on large scale, and whether the extent of the guarantee by the government is sufficient in the current state of or the level of risks. So there are some still some questions regarding the details of this package and the speed at which the bureaucracy will be able to process all these requests for payments, both for the self-employed, for the unemployed, and the speed at which the financial system will be able to process and provide the needed credit for people, for households, and for businesses to actually be able to bridge the fact that they don't have any incomes for the period of the lockdown. And hopefully the government also will come up with a scheme to encourage businesses to rehire and to bring back people who are on temporary leave as soon as the lockdown is relaxed, as soon as the restrictions are lifted, so that these businesses will actually have the incentive to rehire and to bring people back into work once the restrictions are being lifted. And if all of this is done, then we will also be able to flatten the recession curve. So flattening the recession curve to a large extent depends on the accompanying macroeconomic measures and the way they're executed, the speed at which they're executed, the bureaucracy, I would say lightening the bureaucracy. And if all of this is done in the best way, hopefully we will have a somewhat flatter recession and shorter recession. So I'll stop here and I'll be happy to take your questions. I don't hear you.
Okay, now you can hear me?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. Okay, so we have a bunch of questions. I'll just read them to you, and you can, in the order that they came in. So for Israel Kasnet from JNS, he asked, what was Israel's goal in selling bonds, especially the 100-year bonds?
Well, first of all, you need to financing. This huge package needs financing. And actually, I think it was a very important move to go ahead, not wait, and issue bonds. And we saw a very successful issuance of bonds by the Ministry of Finance. I think the 100-year bond is also a statement of confidence at the Israeli economy. So I think that was as part of the whole package. I think it was an important statement by investors that they really believe in the Israeli economy. But the need to issue bonds is really the need for financing, and it was very well done.
Okay. The next question is from Steve Shear from Reuters. He's writing about the housing market. If spending is down, is there a negative wealth effect? What will happen to the housing market? Do you see a bubble bursting, no change in prices, or a small decline?
It's hard to say, actually. It's one of the markets that will probably, if I have to sort of expect, I would say that I don't expect to see a large demand for housing, and it may slow things down there, but I haven't worked it, and I think the uncertainty is huge. But I also see another question regarding the long-term implications of massive spending.
That was the next question.
Right, and the increase in the deficit. Well, I think that at the moment, it's very important to actually take all the measures in order to reduce the long-term damage to the economy as a result of this lockdown. And yes, it means higher deficit, and yes, it means higher debt, and yes, it means that we will have to finance it over time, over the years. But if we don't take this measure, the effect on the economy will be even more devastating, and I think the cost of that will be huge. So I think it's, and actually governments around the world learned from past experiences, and that's why we see those huge packages, including by governments that are very reluctant in normal times to actually spend more or show any deficits at all. And they all understand that not taking these measures will actually make this short-term event into a much longer and deeper recession.
Okay, I have another question from Mehul from the Financial Times. He's asking, would you be able to step back from the specifics of this rescue package and talk a little bit about the larger competing economic theories here? Many European nations have decided to prop up individual incomes, while the US has largely decided to prop up companies via loans and emergency funding. Israel seems to be doing a bit of both, with the increased funding for unemployment insurance and then the credit package. How do we measure which approach will have the largest effect in flattening the recession?
Well, I think that the mix of the two means that you provide the best chances for people to actually come back, get back to their jobs, and have the income that would maintain them for the time for which they don't have income, and businesses to be there once the shutdown is over. And this way, I think the chances that less human capital and capital will be lost, and the economy will be in a better shape to once the shutdown is over. So I think this combination is really necessary. I think another feature that is important is to focus the benefits on those who were actually most affected by the restrictions and by the shutdown. I think there was one measure that was announced recently by the Prime Minister, which seems less focused, which is to provide some subsidy very broadly to all families with kids and to the elderly. And there, I think this particular measure, which is a small proportion of the whole package, is less focused. So I think we have to be really tailoring the measures to where the highest damage was done, in order to prepare for the next phase when the lockdown is over.
Okay, I have a few more questions. One question, I'm not sure where it's from. What are the advantages and problems specifically of the Israel economy that, in your opinion, have influenced for good or bad the challenge of this present crisis? Like, what were our initial strengths and weaknesses that prepared us or weakened us for this challenge?
Generally, I think the crisis came at a time where the Israeli economy had been in a very good shape in many respects. We had a record rate of employment, record low unemployment. We had growth. We have current account surplus. We have relatively low public debt, and we have very solid banks that actually accumulated a lot of capital and liquidity that allows them now to provide credit to those in need. So I think the Israeli economy in general, at least from a macroeconomic standpoint, was in very good shape, which makes it somewhat easier to deal with some elements of the shocks, but the massive proportion of the shock means that still, in spite of the relatively strong and solid place, it's still a very, very difficult shock. And actually, unemployment went from a record low of 3.6% to something around 24% now, which there has never been. It's a record from the time of the beginning of the state. So it's really of massive proportions.
Okay, and finally, I have one more question. Is there, what should the government be doing, and what is the government doing that it shouldn't be doing? So in both directions.
I think it's very important to, I think the big elements are there. But I mentioned a couple of things that I think will need to be followed up very quickly and closely, and see, for example, whether the credit program actually provides the right criteria to allow actually many of these other than under the circumstances, solid firms to actually get the credit. There is also a need to see whether there are some groups of people that, given the criteria for the various benefits and grants, fall between the cracks. So I think it's very important to follow closely the implementation and correct any of these imperfections in the design of some of the measures as they show up, when we see that some groups are not some groups that had been affected are not actually eligible according to the criteria. As I said, this kind of programs had to be put up relatively quickly, and I'm sure that there are a lot of areas where when you design a program, it's not perfect, but you have to be flexible enough to fix it along the way and quickly.
I understand. Okay, one other question came in from Stephen from Reuters. Do you believe that the Bank of Israel will lower interest rates like the other central banks?
I don't know, but I think you should remember that the interest rate is 0.25. So it's low as it is. And I think the Bank of Israel took very substantial measures to provide liquidity, to reduce the whole yield curve by purchasing a very substantial amount of government bonds. So I think it did, it took the measures necessary under the circumstances.
Okay, well, I think we can wrap it up. Those are our final questions. I'd like to thank you, Karnit, for your time and everyone for participating. And of course, a happy and healthy Passover to all. Happy holidays.
Happy holidays. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you. Bye-bye.